is another scene unfolding at this hour. Another deadly school shooting, this time at a high school in Knoxville, Tennessee. Multiple gunshot victims, including a city police officer. The school and surrounding area for a time placed on lockdown. And tonight, federal authorities are on the scene. Here's ABC's Victor Kennedy.
Tonight, federal authorities are on the scene in Knoxville investigating a school shooting that left at least one person dead. Police responding to reports of an armed individual inside Austin East Magnet High School in Knoxville just after 3 p.m. Shots were fired as they approached.
We are not sure exactly how many victims there are. We do know that multiple people have been shot, including a KPD officer.
That officer shot at least once and taken to the hospital. The mayor telling our station WATD that the officer is conscious and alert. Authorities evacuating the school and locking down the surrounding area. One male denounced the scene, another male detained for further investigation. The governor reacting during a scheduled news conference late today.
Pray for that situation and for the families and the victims that might be affected by that in our state.
This school is no stranger to gun violence. Four teenagers who attended Austin East have been shot and killed in just the last few months. This community is shaken tonight.
In his final moments, George Floyd called out for his mother. On the witness stand today, his brother described the relationship as one of a kind.
He was a big mama boy. He would later just lay up on the earth in the fetus position like he was still in a war. He showed us how to treat our mom and how to respect our mom. He loved her so dearly.
The prosecution has called 38 witnesses, 10 of them doctors and other medical experts. Today, cardiologist Jonathan Rich knocking down defense claims Floyd's drug use and heart disease led to the death, saying Floyd would have lived, not for the officers.
Do you have an opinion to reach with great medical certainty as to whether Mr. Floyd's death was preventable?
Yes, I believe that Mr. George Floyd's death was absolutely preventable.
A dozen members of law enforcement have testified against Derek Chauvin. Today, Seth Stoughton, a former officer and an expert on the use of force, summing up what so many others have said.
No reasonable officer would have believed that that was appropriate, acceptable, or reasonable use of force.
So let's get back to Alex Perez with us again tonight from Minneapolis. And Alex, the defense now expected to get his part of the case tonight.
Yeah, David, and we expect the defense's case will be much shorter than the prosecution's. The judge telling the jury today that they should expect closing arguments on Monday. Also told them to pack a bag because they will be sequestered once deliberations begin. David?
Sorry, Alex Perez there in Minneapolis. Thank you, Alex. It's great to have you with us as we start another week together here. It is a difficult, heavy start to the week. That deadly school shooting, what we're learning right now as we come on. But we're going to begin tonight with the police body cam now released after the death of a young young black man, a young father, outside Minneapolis. It happened during a traffic stop yesterday afternoon, and tonight authorities now say they believe the female officer, a senior officer on the force, mistook her gun for her taser. The family and the community horrified. Tonight a curfew is now in place. That police body cam video showing Dante Wright outside his car. Then you can see him trying to get back inside the car. He does get back inside. You can hear one officer saying, "I'll tase you." She then says, "Taser, taser," then firing a shot from her handgun instead. Dante Wright driving a few blocks before crashing into another car. Paramedics arriving on the scene where he was declared dead. As word spread, protesters gathered. Police and riot here. The protest is turning violent. After dark, police lobbing flashbangs, sending people running. Dante Wright's mother tonight saying he called her during a traffic stop, and amid her heartbreak, she's now calling for calm. President Biden today saying the pain in that community is real, it is serious, in his words, calling for peace and calm and for a thorough investigation. Tonight, that officer on administrative leave at ABC's Stephanie Ramos leads us off on the scene just outside Minneapolis in a warning. This video is difficult.
Tonight, new body camera video showing the moment a Minnesota officer fatally shot 20-year-old Dante Wright. Police say the female officer, a veteran on the force, accidentally discharged a gun instead of a taser, killing the father of a 2-year-old.
It is my belief that the officer had the intention to deploy their taser, but instead shot Mr. Wright with a single bullet. This was an accidental discharge that resulted in a tragic death for Mr. Wright.
The incident began just before 2 o'clock Sunday afternoon when authorities say Wright was pulled over for an expired vehicle registration outside of Minneapolis. Wright's girlfriend, also in the car. According to the Brooklyn Center Police Department, the officers ran Wright's name through their system, discovering there was a warrant out for his arrest. Court records show that warrant was issued after Wright failed to appear in court earlier this month, following charges of possessing a firearm without a permit and running away from law enforcement. Police say on Sunday, Wright was trying to get back into the vehicle as officers attempted to apprehend him. The officer warning, "I'll tase ya." Then she pulls a firearm, firing a shot at Wright. The car driving for several blocks before crashing into another vehicle. Wright was pronounced dead at the scene. The medical examiner identifying Wright's cause of death as a gunshot wound to the chest. Tonight, the officer who pulled the trigger is on administrative leave, pending an independent investigation.
We cannot afford to make mistakes that lead to the loss of life. And so I do fully support releasing the officer of the duties.
Overnight, protests erupting. Tensions already high in the city with the trial of Derek Chauvin just 10 miles away.
Our hearts are aching right now. We are in pain right now. And we recognize that this couldn't have happened at a worse time.
President Biden weighing in.
We do know that the anger, pain, and trauma that exists in the black community in that environment is real, it's serious, and it's consequential. We should listen to Dante's mom, who is calling for peace and calm.
Dante's mother, heartbroken.
They don't want all of this. All of this they want to be home. All of us, I don't want to be home.
There was some. That's what I read.
Stephanie Robbins with us tonight from Brooklyn Center outside Minneapolis. And Stephanie, I know the governor tonight announcing a curfew in the Twin Cities metro area. They're bracing for more protests.
Yes, David, and you can already see a large crowd of protesters gathered outside the Brooklyn Center Police Department behind me. That curfew does go into effect tonight from 7 o'clock this evening until 6 o'clock tomorrow morning in multiple cities, including Minneapolis and right here in Brooklyn Center. And police tell us that communities will see an increased presence of the Minnesota National Guard and other law enforcement. David.
All right, Stephanie Marcus, leading us off tonight. Stephanie, thank you. Also learning more tonight after that traffic stop involving an Army lieutenant in uniform pulled over officers with guns drawn. The lieutenant, you will hear what he says to the officer explaining who he was before they then pepper sprayed him behind the wheel. Here's ABC's Steve Oaks himself.
What are you, a special corporal? What are you? Lieutenant, get out of the car!
And this police body camera video that's at the heart of a federal civil rights lawsuit tonight.
Get out of the car now! Get out of the car!
You hear the man behind the wheel try to explain that he's an Army lieutenant and that he did nothing wrong.
I'm honestly afraid to get out. Can I?
Yeah, get out! Get out!
What's going on?
Lieutenant Carol Nazario is black and Latino and is dressed in his Army fatigues. He was driving home in this brand new black SUV in December. The police in Windsor, Virginia say they pulled him over because he didn't have proper license plates. But notice right here are the temporary plates sitting in the back window. The lieutenant admits he didn't stop for about 2 minutes until he got to this gas station where it was well lit. And when he refuses to leave his SUV, one of the officers pulls out the pepper spray.
Please relax.
Get out of the car now.
This is not how you treat a bad dog. I'm actively serving this country, and this is how you're going to treat me. I didn't do it. Whoa, hold on. What's going on? Hold on.
You see the officer who used the pepper spray now.
It's not obvious. Right.
He was released with no charges and is suing police.
It could have been.
Gutierrez has been fired, saying that at the conclusion of this investigation, it was determined that Windsor Police Department policy was not followed.
Tonight, the most senior enlisted soldier in the U.S. Army is supporting the lieutenant, saying that he represented himself and our Army well through his calm, professional response to the situation. I'm very proud of him. The Windsor Police Department outside Norfolk says it has been putting its officers in additional training since January because of this incident. David?
All right. Based on
Steve Olson, sorry. The index of other news and President Biden's nomination for Secretary of the Army making history tonight. President naming Christine Warren. If confirmed, she would become the first woman to hold the position. She served at the Pentagon during the Obama administration. Overseas tonight, and to the preparations now underway for the funeral for Britain's Prince Philip. Tonight, Prince Harry is back in the UK, and both Princes William and Harry with their own tributes. ABC's James Long from London, again to see you.
Tonight, a grandson's homecoming. Harry, back in the UK ahead of Prince Philip's funeral, joining the royal family at Windsor for a scaled-down service for just 30 people Saturday due to COVID-19 restrictions. Pregnant Meghan still in LA with Archie. Physicians advised against travel. The Duke of Sussex honouring Philip's life of public service, but in typical form, Harry struck a more informal note, saying, "He was my grandpa, master of the barbecue, legend of banter, and cheeky right till the end." It finished with a phrase, "By sea, by land," the motto of the Royal Marines, a nod to Philip's glittering naval career. Prince William also paying tribute today, saying, "I will never take for granted the special memories my children will always have of their great-grandpa." Releasing this photo of the young Prince George with Philip, the father, grandfather, and great-grandfather of future kings. The princes will join their father Charles walking behind Philip's casket, recalling the iconic moment the Duke accompanied William and Harry behind their mother Diana over 20 years ago. The family is united in grief this evening, David. Harry's return could help heal the many rifts that exist. That is certainly something that Britain is hoping for tonight.
David, all right, James, we'll see you Saturday morning, James. We're going to have live coverage of Prince Philip's funeral Saturday morning right here. Deborah Roberts, James Longman joining me with our entire team bidding farewell to Prince Philip Saturday morning, 9:30 a.m. Eastern. We'll see you then.
Existing customer, and I'd like your best new smartphone.
Actually, it's for both new and existing customers.
Oh, I feel silly. But I do want Nationwide 5G.
I want Nationwide 5G.
Are we actually doing this again?
It's not complicated. All AT&T gives new and existing customers the same great deal. Like Samsung Galaxy S21 5G for free when you trade in.
Their handgun.
as we in this country still try to control this virus, there is news about how one small country is using testing to do that. Tell us about it.
Exactly. And so while we're focusing on vaccination, which is obviously massively important, we can't lose sight of the other mitigation measures to control this pandemic and lessons learned from another part of the world, Slovakia. They have used weekly rapid antigen testing, whereby if one person has positive, everyone living in that person's household is then quarantined for 14 days. They're doing this voluntarily. There's good compliance. They have found their case rates have dropped by 58% when they started instituting these measures. So, again, there is an indication there that it's not just about prevention with vaccination, but screening, which can also be an important tool in our toolbox as we reopen here.
All right, so Slovakia, not the United States. Notably, I heard voluntary and compliance.
That's
so
right.
How can we use some of what they've learned here?
And also size. Obviously, they're a very small country there. This exercise was really implemented by their military, so there are a lot of logistical issues. But yes, we could see this used more for schools, universities, workplaces, companies. Whether or not people follow the results and then self-quarantine, that's TBD, to be determined. But I think it's something that we need to keep in mind, that it's not just about vaccination. This is an interesting lesson, and we've learned in this pandemic that we do have to learn what other countries are doing.
That's right, and we're always learning.
Yeah, right, Dr. Chen?
Thank you.
Existing customer, and I'd like your best new smartphone deal.
Actually, it's for both new and existing customers.
Oh, I feel silly. But I do want nationwide 5G.
I want nationwide 5G.
Are we actually doing this again?
It's not complicated. Only AT&T gives new and existing customers the same rate deals, like the Samsung Galaxy S21 5G for free when you trade in.
Going to turn out to ABC's Face of Blue Bay in Washington with the latest headlines for us. Good afternoon, Faith.
Hey, good afternoon to you, AB. Hope everyone is doing great on this Monday. We begin with a violence igniting overnight in Minnesota after that death of another black man at the hands of police. Those tensions erupting at the Brooklyn Central Police Station. Officials using tear gas to clear the crowds. The Minnesota National Guard deployed after word spread of a traffic stop Sunday afternoon ending in the death of a 20-year-old black man shot by police, identified by family members as Dante Wright. Police say the driver tried to elude them after they discovered an outstanding warrant for his arrest. And that incident taking place just about 10 miles from where the Derrick Chauvin trial now begins its third week. The ex-police officer accused in the murder of George Floyd. Family members planning to take the stand this week to testify about the kind of person Floyd was. Chauvin's attorney maintains the officer did not cause George Floyd's death. And now to the volcanic mess in the Caribbean. Inches of ash covering parts of the island of St. Vincent, set to look like a battle zone. About 60,000 residents rescued out of the most dangerous areas. Other islands affected too. That ash raining down on nearby Barbados as well. And Prince Harry returns to the UK as Britons prepare to say goodbye to Prince Philip. The funeral to be held Saturday in Windsor. Harry expected to walk the route with his brother and his father. The first reunion of royals since Harry and wife Meghan's explosive interview with Oprah Winfrey. Meghan at home here in the U.S. said to be under doctor's orders not to travel. And finally, history on the green. Hideki Matsuyama, the first Japanese player to ever win the Masters, donning that green jacket at Augusta National with pride, of course, after writing out a little trouble on the back nine, his caddy bowing at that last hole there. And the 29-year-old Matsuyama managing to make history with his whole country watching every single stroke. You can just imagine the pressure there. But he did it, Amy.
Yeah, I love that big smile on his face, and green is a good color for him. Well, thank you very much, Faith. Administration is continuing to grapple with the influx of migrants at the U.S.-Mexico border, reporting over 100.
Immigration Forum, Ali Noorani. Ali, thank you so much for being with us. And yes, we have all seen those heartbreaking images of what's happening at our southern border. We know a lot of them are turned away, but the Biden administration is expecting children. What needs to happen? What needs to change?
Well, what needs to happen is that the Biden administration needs to set up the infrastructure, the logistics, and the processes so that children can go through the process in a safe and humane way. And fortunately, the Biden administration is well on the path to achieving that. They started to co-host border protection and health and human service staff so that the initial intake goes quicker. They're standing at facilities in Texas and other places across the country. And then most importantly, they're putting into place the system so that as children are, you know, are receiving their initial interviews, being vetted by Health and Human Services, that they're eventually being put in the care of either a legal guardian or a foster home. So we are hoping that the process is really starting to pick up pace now.
But is there a PR problem? Is there a messaging problem coming from or not coming from the Biden administration? Because clearly people are sending their children to the border, in some cases alone or in very dangerous conditions, thinking and knowing that they'll be accepted.
Well, I think the bigger problem here is that as a nation, for so long, we've been outsourced our immigration system to cartels. So what's happening when you're in Honduras, Guatemala, or El Salvador is that the cartels and human smugglers on the streets are, in essence, selling a lie to desperate families for anywhere between $6,000 and $10,000 a pop. And with that lie, they're saying that lie is more or less telling these families that the United States border is open. The Biden administration has spent, you know, considerable resources on public education campaigns in Central America. But remember, the cartels, they are savvy, they're sophisticated, and they have a track record of getting people to the border because, again, Congress has failed to fix the system. So the question is, how do countries like Central America, Mexico, and the U.S. disrupt these smuggling networks, but do so in a way that protects the safety of these families?
Day one in office, we heard from the Biden administration, they reversed the ban on Muslim immigration here into this country. How far has that gone, and what more needs to be done to rectify what went wrong before in the former Trump administration?
Well, it was a great first step on that first day to eliminate that Muslim ban. Yet the Biden administration has not moved forward with increasing the number of refugees that we will resettle in the United States. In fact, just over the last few days, a new report by the International Rescue Committee found that under the Biden administration, they have A, not increased the level of refugees to be resettled, B, that we're on track to resettle less than 5,000 refugees this year. Keep in mind that over 80 million people are displaced around the world. And third, and most importantly, Muslims are going to be disproportionately affected. In fact, under the Biden administration, only 42 Syrian refugees have been resettled in the United States. And there's just no other way to put it other than it's just a moral failure on the part of the United States. And it's something that President Biden can fix with a one stroke of a pen.
Ali, I one of my favorite lines from Hamilton is, immigrants, we get the job done. So we know we have so many hardworking immigrant families who are small business owners in this country. Talk a little bit about what this pandemic has done to those businesses. Have they been more severely impacted than others?
Well, immigrant-owned businesses employ over 8 million workers across the country. The majority of those workers are native-born American workers. They generate over $1 trillion in economic output. You know, there was research just released, I believe, last fall that over a third of immigrant-owned businesses experienced a significant loss because of COVID-19. We need to make sure that the administration, whether it's the Biden administration or even state and local governments, are really reaching out to immigrant business owners who are really revitalizing the neighborhoods across the country that so depend on, you know, the infusion of energy and talent that comes with the immigrant community. So it has been a long road, just like it's been for all of us over the course of this pandemic. But fortunately, immigrants, whether they're business owners or workers, are standing shoulder to shoulder with U.S. citizens to get our nation through COVID-19. So yes, there's a lot that can be done. But I think ultimately it will be the energy and the entrepreneurship of immigrants as well as those who've been here for generations.
Well, President and CEO of the National Immigration Forum, Ali Noorani, thank you so much for your time. We really appreciate it. Some very interesting insights there. So we appreciate your time today.
Thank you so much.
pandemic has affected everything that we do at school, so we've had to rethink how to come into the building, how we eat lunch, how we dismiss from school, how we sit in the classrooms. We did have a fear during the school year, yes, that we would have to close our doors, and it actually came about right after Thanksgiving break. We saw more COVID cases after fall break. We were saved by our college students that came in and filled in some openings that we had. We have had a couple of staff that have been schooling for a while who took close contact, and our college kids were able to step in and take over the classes and kind of save us, honestly.
So I was born and raised in the town of Greenfield, Indiana, so I'm pretty tight-knit with Greenfield Central Community School Corporation.
One night I was at home, and my dad was like, "Have you ever thought of being a substitute teacher?" And I was like, "Okay, well, how do you do it?"
When all of our substitutes were unavailable, I think that's when our staff kind of reached out to our college students who were available at the time and said, "Hey, can you come and fill a need that our schools have?"
Every day feels like the first day. It's so helpful because every single group of kids you have are different and have different needs, but it took a little bit of getting used to.
It was actually an easier adjustment than I thought it would be. And it was, in terms of preparation, I just said, okay, well, I'm just going to be the nicest person that I can and be kind to all these students because, you know, I don't want to be known as the guy who wasn't the cool substitute teacher.
Cooper was great. Cooper came in and he had a great attitude. So if the lesson plan called for him to get a science lesson or roll up his sleeves and do some work with some students, he jumped right in there.
They have no idea how old I actually am. They're like, "Are you 16? Are you 30? I'm like, "No, I'm only 20, guys."
Grace, I remember being very, very professional. She came in and I got the job done. Our progress during this pandemic has been surprising. But think of all the schools that were not able to come back on site. And I'm very fortunate and very blessed to be able to have our students back on site for as long as we have this school. We're very excited about that.
Students, humble students, I love.
Existing customer, and I'd like your best new smartphone.
Actually, it's for both new and existing customers.
I feel silly. But I do want nationwide 5G.
I want nationwide 5G.
Are we actually doing this again?
It's not complicated. All AT&T gives new and existing customers the same great deals, like the Samsung Galaxy S21 5G for free when you trade in.
Turmeric supplements, what about cautions for older people with atrial fibrillation?
always red flags when you talk about supplements. It's always preferable in the world of nutritional science to get your source from real food. So if you're talking about turmeric, use the real spice, because studies have been done where they've looked at these supplements. Oftentimes they have fillers in them, they may have contaminants, their purity is hard to ascertain. In general, this is a well-tolerated, you know, spice or supplement. Some people may get some GI distress. It may, underscore may, increase the risk of bleeding. So again, you want to pursue the caution. And like I said, just use it out of the spice bottle.
Yeah, I like it in my eggs.
Me too. And your tea.
Yes,
you tried it in tea.
Very, very good.
There we go.
You bet. You can submit your questions to Dr. Jen on her Instagram at Dr. J. Ashton.
Iran is blaming Israel for an explosion at one of its major nuclear sites. The blast is setting back Iran's ability to enrich uranium, and the government is now threatening revenge. Ian Panels in London with the latest. Ian, good morning.
Yeah, good morning, Diane. Iran pointing the finger of blame directly at Israel this morning, accusing it of sabotage and promising revenge. Now, the blast of the Natanz nuclear site on Sunday is believed to have dealt a severe blow to the country's ability to enrich uranium. That's according to American and Israeli intelligence sources speaking to the Times. Iran's critics accuse the country of wanting to enrich uranium to make nuclear weapons. This is something that the Iranians have consistently denied. And they say they know who is responsible, calling it an act of terrorism. Now, the Israelis are making no comment as expected. But the U.S. Secretary of Defense, Lloyd Austin, who's in Israel for meetings, saying that he plans on reassuring the Israeli leadership of America's commitment as a strategic partner. This isn't the first attack of its kind in the country, nor the first attack of its kind at this particular facility. But of course, it comes at a critical time, as both Iran and the U.S. are re-engaging over this nuclear agreement, with the idea that the U.S. will rejoin it. There will be concerns today that this latest incident could derail those efforts. Diane?
All right, Ian Panel in London for us. Thanks, Ian. Prince Harry is returning to the UK for his grandfather, Prince Philip's, funeral. It's the first time Harry has been back since stepping down from royal duties. He's expected to join his father, Prince Charles, and brother, Prince William, at the funeral, marking the first time they'll be together since his explosive interview with Oprah. Here's James Longman with the latest.
Britain is preparing to say goodbye to Prince Philip, but the coronavirus means a more scaled-back event just for family, and that will include Prince Harry flying in especially for his grandfather's funeral. It's the first time you will have seen them in more than a year since he and Meghan served out their final engagements as working royals before stepping back officially from public duties.
Meghan very much wanted to come, but she was advised by her physician not to travel. Clearly disappointing for her, for Harry, but you could say in some ways that her not being here might simplify things in some ways if you're looking at the possibility of a brother-to-brother conversation, for example.
The funeral for the 99-year-old prince will be held Saturday in Windsor. Harry is expected to join his father, Prince Charles, and brother, Prince William, walking behind Philip's casket. A moving reminder of a similar scene from over 20 years ago, when the Duke walked with his grandsons behind their mother, Diana.
My dear papa was a very special person who, I think above all else, would have been amazed by the reaction and the touching things that have been said about him. We are, my family, deeply grateful for all that. It will sustain us in this particular loss and at this particularly sad time.
I love Winnie to Betsy, my brother. We've been through hell together, and we have a shared experience, but we were different apart.
It may be a rocky homecoming. Meghan and Harry alleged in that sit-down with Oprah that, among other things, a member of the royal family made racist remarks about the possible skin colour of their child. Harry said the comment did not come from his grandmother, Queen Elizabeth, or his grandfather, but it was a bombshell claim.
Can you tell us what the question was?
No, I'm not comfortable sharing that.
Okay.
But that was right at the beginning, right?
What will the baby look like?
Yeah, what will the kids look like?
Meghan also alleged she was suicidal, but received no help from the firm. and Harry claimed his father wouldn't take his call at the time and that they were cut off financially. In rallying around the Queen at this difficult time, the family may find their own differences mended. That is certainly the hope.
We are seeing the royal family very united in their grief, and I think that's going to continue to be the case. And it could be an opportunity for them to have discussions and work through some of the real disagreements that have taken place.
So you saw there Prince Charles speaking about his father over the weekend. His sister, Princess Anne, and two brothers, Edward and Andrew, have all spoken, and now the next generation of the royal family are making public comments. In the last few moments, we've had Prince Philip with a very heartfelt message. He said, "My grandfather's century of life was defined by service to his country and Commonwealth, to his wife and Queen, and to our family." He goes on to say, "I'm very lucky to have not just had his example to guide me, but his enduring presence well into my own adult life, both through good times and the hardest days. I will always be grateful. My wife had so many years to get to know my grandfather and for the kindness he showed her. I will never take for granted the special memories my children will always have of their great-grandpa, coming to collect them in his carriage and seeing for themselves his infectious sense of adventure as well as his mischievous sense of humour. My grandfather was an extraordinary man and part of an extraordinary generation. Catherine and I will continue to do what he would have wanted and will support the Queen in the years ahead. I'll miss my grandpa, but I know he would want us all to get on with the job." So it's a very, very personal message there from Prince William in memory of his grandfather, Prince Philip.
It is, and we know that tributes are coming in from leaders all over the world for Prince Philip. James, what can we expect at the funeral on Saturday? I know COVID is going to make things a little bit different than they otherwise would have been.
Absolutely. You know, for someone of Prince Philip's stature, you'd expect hundreds of people here, foreign kings and queens, princes, politicians, pop stars. There will be none of that. It'll just be a very personal service for the 30 closest members of the royal family here at Windsor, St. George's Chapel, along the lines, really, of what Philip himself would have wanted. He didn't really want people to make a lot of fuss about him. His casket is currently at Windsor Chapel, private chapel here on the Windsor estate. It'll be brought down on Saturday morning to St. George's Chapel, and that is where the service will go ahead. We'll all be watching on television, but it will be a personal service there.
James Longman at Windsor Castle. Maybe the service he wanted after all. James, thank you. And we will have live coverage of the funeral of Prince Philip beginning Saturday morning at 9:30 Eastern here on ABC News Live.
Just the past week, the CDC ranking Michigan the number one hotspot in the country.
treat, and hospitals feeling the strain. Some patients facing 8 to 10 hour wait times. Those hospitalized shifting away from now vaccinated older Americans to those unvaccinated younger adults.
Now we're seeing that kind of 40 to 59 age group as the largest group that's getting infected. We're certainly seeing some children that are getting ill, but it's really that young adult population that's driving a lot of the cases. So for us, this surge is bigger than it was a year ago.
Doctors say driving the surge, a mix of reduced restrictions, pandemic fatigue, and the UK variant, which now accounts for 70% of the new cases in Michigan. The federal government now sending Michigan more personnel to administer vaccines, though Governor Gretchen Whitmer doubling down that our state needs more shots.
When there is a surge, we think that it's important that we rush in to meet where that need is.
Across the country, the supply of Johnson & Johnson vaccine is expected to drop 85% this week, but there are glimmers of hope. Deaths have declined since the January peak, and the U.S. travel industry is starting to rebound after the CDC said fully vaccinated Americans could safely travel.
And doctors here say they do have better treatment protocols for COVID patients now than they did during that first surge. And while that isn't able to keep them from those patients being seriously ill and having to be hospitalized, it is helping them keep those ICUs overflowing.
Robin, that is encouraging. Even we know that Pfizer is now asking the FDA to expand authorization of this vaccine for use in children as young as 12.
That's right, Robin. The FDA is reviewing that request, and the CDC's director says that she expects that that FDA authorization will come in about mid-May. Robin, over.
To the fallout from that traffic stop. Police drawing their guns and pepper spraying a black army lieutenant who was in uniform. That soldier now suing over the stop, and the governor of Virginia ordering the state police to investigate. Steve Oversharman has all the details. Good morning, Steve. Good morning, Steve. There's a federal civil rights lawsuit over this video, which people are just now getting to see, and the army officer seen in the video was driving home.
Big to get wrong.
Saying that at the conclusion of this investigation, it was determined that Windsor Police Department policy was not followed. The local police say they have now ordered additional training for officers department-wide starting in January. The state police of Virginia just announced they are investigating this incident.
Oh, that's it.
Now in the Caribbean Islands, St. Vincent,
where volcanic eruptions forced thousands of residents to flee their homes. Conditions are worsening. Officials say the island looks like a battle zone.
Good morning, George. Just hours ago, emergency management on the island reported another large eruption. Experts there
are telling
everyone to heed the warnings, as these eruptions could continue for weeks, maybe even months.
This morning, the Caribbean island of St. Vincent is covered in ash. A long dormant volcano crumbling over the weekend, blasting giant clouds of smoke into the sky. Officials say the island looks like a battle zone.
Right.
The first eruption early Friday morning, followed by a second one just hours later. Authorities say plumes of smoke are rising about 25,000 feet high. Asphalt blanketing cars, damaging homes and businesses, and knocking out power. About 16,000 St. Vincent residents have been evacuated out of the most dangerous areas surrounding the Massoupierre volcano. Adrian Simmons and his friends made multiple trips by boat and by car to remove residents from the danger over the weekend.
This is all paradise. When I walk the streets, my feet were literally sinking inches into the ash. I can't believe this is my beautiful hometown.
Three ships coming to the rescue.
What did I say? What did I say? Tell me.
Are on board yet. Other islands are affected too. Ash traveling across more than 100 miles of ocean to the nearby island of Barbados. Ash raining down like snow, turning the daytime sky dark.
Many nearby islands have offered to take in those evacuees. The State Department spokesperson telling ABC News they're not aware of any U.S. citizens that have been affected by this. That president we heard from, he's been working around the clock. Robin, he tells us he doesn't want to leave anyone behind.
It is. I'll do it, but it's not.
Hi, I'm a new customer and I want your best new smartphone. Well, I'm an existing customer and I'd like your best new smartphone.
Actually, it's for both new and existing customers.
Oh, I feel silly. But do you want nationwide 5G?
I want nationwide 5G.
Are we actually doing this again?
It's not complicated. All AT&T gives new and existing customers the same great deals, like the Samsung Galaxy S21 5G for free when you trade in.
Now that severe weather down south, bringing damaging winds, multiple reported tornadoes from Louisiana to North Carolina now. A new storm is on the move. Rob is in for Ginger, tracking that for us. Good morning, Rob.
Hey, good morning, Robin. It was such a rough weekend for the south. Beginning early Saturday morning, EF-320 going through Palmetto, Louisiana. This is a damage it did. Seven injuries, and there was one fatality. Just an intense tornado, 140 miles per hour, and hitting during the middle of the night, the most horrifying time. Later that day, a tornado coming in off the Gulf of Mexico was a waterspout. This was intense as well. Panama City Beach seemed significant damage as this came ashore. And these had some serious straight-line winds with them as well. Just down the beach from there, Pensacola, Florida. Look at that. Looks like a hurricane coming through. The winds reported at 80 miles per hour at Fort Washington. All the way down to the Tampa Bay area as well. Babies in Florida seen some serious damage. Roof damage there. Just north of Tampa, there was a teenager that was killed from a falling tree fatality there. All right, that storm is now gone, but the next one is coming into Texas today. And we look for severe weather in the way of mostly damaging wind in North Carolina, South Dallas, all the way down to the Rio Grande. This storm will have some rain.
I thought it was a relative, okay.
New home construction and the math adds up to sky-high prices. This morning, with the housing market red hot,
Yeah, that's pretty good. Okay. Let me what I knew, please. Turkey. The rest of Turkey. We took away Turkey, and they took away Cuba. Robert Kennedy negotiated with a sympathetic Russian important person.
Silly.
But I do want nationwide 5G.
I want nationwide 5G.
Are we actually doing this again?
It's not complicated. Only AT&T gives new and existing customers the same great deals, like the Samsung Galaxy S21 5G for free when you trade in.
Keep it up, smash.
Hey George, good morning. Yeah, the Oscars are less than 2 weeks away. Everyone's speculating about who the big winners are going to be. And with the BAFTAs being one of the last major last night, it's like a
smash. I thought that was his father. I think his father's name is John.
Yesterday, what a day in golf. The four-day tournament
sharing that. Loved watching it. With that, George, I know you were watching as well. I was sending it back to you in the studio.
Thank you, Lynette.
It's the Parent Series, the online platform for helping parents with newborns, teens, and everything in between. And this morning, one postpartum nurse and mother is mixing her professional and tactful advice to help new moms and dads in those early days. Bringing home a bundle of joy isn't always a walk in the park. Just ask registered postpartum nurse and soon-to-be mom of four, Carrie Locker.
Wait, nobody told me about this. Nobody told me about that.
Carrie launched her Instagram page last spring, using her professional and personal experience to help families transition from hospital to home. The 29-year-old created a loyal audience of over 235,000 followers in just 1 year, like Marisol Mena, who is set to welcome her baby girl Olive next month.
As a first-time mom, and I know a lot of the things that come with bringing a baby.
That's
why you have me. I'm here, yes.
Carrie's first tip, make
bath. He may have been here.
Focus on body first. Get them all cleaned up, get them dried off, new jammies, fresh diaper, and then we can focus on their hair. Once you swallow, baby, you have control of Olive's head here, where you can actually submerge her scalp underwater by the faucet. Wash her hair, shampoo.
When tummy troubles strike, Carrie recommends an I Love You abdominal massage to relieve gas.
You're making an I, an L, and a U. On the baby's left side of their abdomen, you just go downwards, making I. And then you start on the other side, the right side of their abdomen, going up and down to make that L. And then you just do it like three times. You always want to do it in the position
is joining us now. Carrie, good morning to you. And we know, hey, we know that getting out of the house is important right now. But what are the diapers and essentials you should not leave home without?
Yes, you want to make sure that you have an extra change of clothes for baby, and I'm going to show you a space-saving way to fold that.
All right.
So you're going to take your shirt out, and then you put your pants on top and fold them in half. You fold your sleeves over top of the outfit. Take your socks with the elastics facing out at the top. And you roll down. And you fasten the socks. So you end up getting a little baby cannoli like this.
Uh-huh.
You did pretty good.
Yeah, you know what? Hey, I have some skills. Changing a baby on the go. This is going to be helpful for parents. What's that?
Yes, absolutely. So this is a great parenting hack. When you go to pull wipes out of the container, you end up getting five or six when you only need one. So if you put a little hair tie or rubber band around one side of the container, you'll only get one when you go to pull it out. Another tip I have is just a car changing kit. I use a reusable wipes container, and I rubber band the wipes to the top of the lid. And that way you have all the space for baby's things to change them inside. And my last tip is babies tend to pee when they're exposed to air. So before opening their diaper up, you can use cold stimuli with a wet wipe and just run it right along the diaper line here.
Are we actually doing this again?
It's not complicated. Only AT&T gives new and existing customers the same great deals. Like the Samsung Galaxy S21 5G for free when you trade in.
Special surprise is the reason I'm hiding behind the band right now. We'll explain that in just a second when I go. We got with this wonderful doctor's husband is going to help us pull off the surprise. But first, take a look at her story. Dr. Ayla Stanford is a highly sought-after pediatric surgeon in Philadelphia. But she put that life on hold when COVID hit, so she could become a lifeline for the city's black and brown communities hit hard by the pandemic. The communities have been left behind.
One of the issues that was pretty blatant was the fact that in order to get a COVID test, they have to have a car to drive up, and there were areas where people had to take a bus to get there and were not allowed to get tested because they weren't driving.
We had a huge population of people who essentially were not able to get tested.
People of color are more likely to have pre-existing conditions like high blood pressure, diabetes, and obesity.
Okay, splinter. We'll go splinter. Okay.
I can remember talking to my sister on the phone, and she in tears. She said, we just have to do something about it.
So what did she do? Rented a van and brought the testing to the people for free. Popping up in church parking lots, rec centers, spots in the most underserved communities.
You can't do better than this lady here. She said, we're going to give people the care that they probably have never received that they deserve.
Within a week, she formed the Black Doctors COVID-19 Consortium, recruiting an army of doctors, nurses, medical students, and professionals that in the past year have administered more than 24,000 COVID tests, and now over 40,000 vaccines throughout Philadelphia.
Good morning. This is my office, where I typically see patients for pediatric surgery, but it has turned into COVID-19 Central.
Dr. Stanford, well, became a bit of a rock star.
This is Dr. Stanford. It's positive that we come get tested by her. She's a good sister.
She's the epitome of caring about your community.
To many people in this community, she is their savior.
Shelly Gaber's father is an organ transplant recipient and an essential worker. She says doctors told the family that if he got COVID, he'd likely die.
There was no place where we could go. That was bringing it to the people in our community, except her. She saved his life. She saved our family. Thank you. Thank you so much, because to you, we matter.
Even West Philly native, the great Hattie LaBelle, got her shot thanks to the doc.
Dr. Stanford is so special because she cares about the world. She calls me a celebrity. She's the diva. She is the celebrity of life. I love you so much for keeping me alive. She is great. She belongs in history.
And her family couldn't be
prouder. We love you, Mom. We are all forever changed.
Hey, Mom. God bless you.
I'm proud beyond all recognition of what you have done. But I'm even prouder of what you've gone through.
Cora.
Whoa, okay,
so
today. This is a vaccination time. Now, you didn't even see the story, but there's something, well,
comment on it or what else? Not slow. I'm gonna start recording again.